We have looked at a number of different aspects of Revelation chapter 17. And this evening we have come to the scarlet colored beast. We have somewhat identified the first five heads, then the sixth, and then we began to touch on the seventh, showing the relationship of the United States of America to the formation of the seventh head. We also hinted, which I'll go a little more in detail, this one and the next one, because we still have to look at the ten kings. We have also hinted that the Babylon the Great, the Confederacy, will be the seventh head. And I call it the U.S.-led coalition that will be the seventh head. U.S.-led coalition, Confederacy, you want to call it, Babylon the Great, U.S.-led, because the last power that will wage war against the church, according to inspiration, will be United States of America. Why? Because the United States of America will play the leading role, and all other nations will follow her example. Foreign nations will follow her example. So I call it the U.S.-led coalition or U.S.-led Confederacy, the union of church and state, that combination that we call Babylon the Great, because it is USA that will assist in the formation of Babylon the Great. All right? And that is where we are at, and I want to deal with this scarlet colored beast as we go along. Now let's start the ball rolling. Now we cannot deal with this scarlet colored beast without hinting and passing by some of the other beasts that I mentioned, which had something in common with the scarlet colored beast. Remember, I said that there were three beasts that are mentioned with seven heads and ten horns. Only three. Seven heads and ten horns. The great red dragon in Revelation chapter 12. Then the beast that comes out of the sea, Revelation 13. The first five verses, one of the heads of which was wounded to death. And then later, the Bible says that the deadly wound was healed and all the world wondered after the beast. But the next time this same beast is mentioned, it's not in Revelation 12, but Revelation chapter 17, as a scarlet, as a scarlet colored beast, with a woman sitting and riding upon it and reigning over it. That is scarlet colored beast. Why is this scarlet colored? Is what we want to deal with as well. Hope we can get to that point. Now, the difference between the three beasts are, even though it's the same, seven heads, ten horns. In the one in Revelation 12, what happened? That beast, seven heads and ten horns. The crowns are on the heads. In Revelation chapter 13, seven heads, ten horns, a beast that arises from the masses, the people, seven heads, ten horns, the crowns are on the horns. And in Revelation 17, seven heads, ten horns, and the crowns are on the, there are no crowns as yet. But we are told about ten kings that will have not received any kingdom as yet. They have not received any crowns as yet. But they will receive power as kings 1 hour with the beast. Revelation 17. All right? That's what it's mentioned. So it's significant. So we have to go back just a little. The dragon. The dragon has some similarities to the scarlet colored beast, because the dragon is mentioned with seven heads and ten horns. Dragon. Who does the dragon primarily represent in Revelation 12? Who does the dragon primarily represent? The Bible says, and that old serpent called the devil, he is the dragon. But in a secondary sense, he represents who? Pagan Rome, that tried to destroy the man child, Jesus Christ, when he was born. But that man child was supposed to rule with a rod of iron and then return back to God, as it were. Revelation 12. Remember, I told you also that Revelation 12 has some of the same language and follows some of the same career paths as Genesis chapter 3, verse 15. Meaning that the long drawn out war is described in more detail in Revelation 12. Genesis 3, it is encapsulated in Genesis 3:15. The dragon was robbed. Genesis 3:15, what does that say again? I will put enmity between thee and the woman, and between thy seed and her seed. He shall bruise thy head, and thou shalt bruise his heel. That is the word there, the great controversy in one verse. And it mentions some of the same language in Revelation chapter 12. It talks about a woman that fled in the wilderness. It talks about a war, enmity between thee and the woman. It talks about the serpent seed, which is those that the devil is robbed with the woman, went to make war with the remnant of the woman's seed, which keep the commandments of God and have the faith of Jesus. So Revelation 12 is a more detailed explanation in terms of the great controversy of Genesis 3:15. And we can see that almost every point in the Bible has its genesis in that book. But remember, the books of Daniel and Revelation will put everything in its right context and show us the bigger picture that we are living under. The midst of a great controversy. The church of God being attacked by the woman's seed, which is Satan and his followers, the serpent seeds, seeking to destroy the church. Just what the prophecy said he would try to do in hitting the woman's seed heel, but that the woman's seed would crush the serpent's head. All that's in Revelation chapter 12. Nicely put out. But that particular chapter closes with this language, similar to Genesis 3:15. And the dragon, which is the serpent, same thing, was wroth with the woman and went to make war, following through the enmity, with the remnant of her seed, which keep the commandments of God and have the faith of Jesus. So there's a direct connection between the two verses. That's all I'm trying to show here. All right? But the first seven-headed beast that we come across in Revelation is the great red dragon, having seven heads and 10 horns. That's the first time you mention it. It is mentioned in Revelation 12:3. And it is also the seven-headed beast that disappears last from the scene. So the last one to go of those three beasts will be the dragon. The sea beast, or what we call the beast that comes out of the sea, disappears before the millennium into the lake of fire, Revelation 19:20. And the dragon is only thrown into the lake of fire after the millennium, Revelation 20:10. Now that's significant. And who then burns the longest? And who then burns the longest because of accumulated guilt of having tempted people and bears the guilt and the shame and sins of all the people in the world? It is the devil. Some people go in a flash. Others burn a little longer than others. And Satan burns the longest. We don't understand the laws involved there, but it has to do with degrees of guilt. Degrees of guilt. And degrees of guilt is usually based on our level or knowledge or understanding. So that's what James says. Those who have little knowledge will be beaten with little stripes, but compared to the other, they will be beaten with many more stripes. The greater condemnation. Those who are the leaders, as it were. Now, in Revelation chapter 12, the beast has seven heads and ten horns. And the crowns are on the heads. We already mentioned that. Revelation 13, the beast has seven heads, ten horns. Crowns are on the horn. But in Revelation 17, while the beast has seven heads and ten horns, there are no crowns at all mentioned. However, the ten horns in Revelation 17 receive power as kings 1 hour with the beast. Now, in the context of the war in heaven, the Bible says there was war where? In heaven. So in the context of the war in heaven, and when imprisoned during the millennium, the war in heaven, the dragon is specifically identified as Satan. All right? During the millennium, remember, he's restricted to planet Earth. And as such, exists for all human history. I want to emphasize that. In the context of the war in heaven, the dragon was seized and imprisoned. Remember, he was bound with chains of circumstances during the 1,000 years. That is identified as Satan, who was bound, Revelation 22. And therefore, starting the war in heaven, then ultimately bound, put into a bottomless pit, solitude in the wilderness, as it were, out of sight, he, we can say, has existed for all human history. And in this sense, it continues to exist even beyond the return of Christ, Revelation 22. And only vanishes from the pages of Revelation when it is thrown into the lake of fire after the millennium, Revelation 20, 10. However, when it is first introduced as standing before the woman, it is presented as having seven heads and ten horns. Both the heads and the horns are kings. And the proof of that, we've looked at these already, Revelation 17, 10 and verse 12 as well. All right. Now, therefore, when in conflict with the woman's child, Jesus, it represents the specific earthly authority at the time of Jesus' earthly life, namely the fourth kingdom or the fourth beast. In Daniel 7, which is the pagan Roman Empire. This is supported by the observation that the dragon would be a good name for the fourth beast of Daniel. And Jesus lived in the time when the Caesars ruled the world, that's pagan Rome. That's the time that Jesus lived. And what was his purpose? Seeking to destroy Christ and hence prevent the emergence of his church. The dragon has been involved in various wars in the past and will be involved in the final war as well against God's remnant church in the end time. The war against the woman before the times and a half, that's the first war. The war against the woman during the times and a half, and the war against the woman's other children, Revelation 12, 17, I just quoted that, which follows after the times and half a time, and is the war of Revelation chapter 13 as well. Now, some of these wars are beyond the time of Imperial Rome. The dragon in these wars may then either represent Satan or the continuing influence of the Roman Empire. The Roman Empire existed the longest in the feet of iron, as it were, in the image of Daniel chapter 2. So that's the dragon, the beast. The sea beast is frequently mentioned as working with the dragon. As the sea beast. Which means that it is not the same as the dragon. The sea beast is different to the dragon. As a matter of fact, the Bible says the dragon gave him his power, seat, and great authority. So the two are not the same. The sea beast is here identified as the little horn of Daniel 7. The same characteristics of the sea beast and that head that was wounded are the same characteristics used to describe the little horn of Daniel 7. It's the same power. And that is the Roman church. And the reasons given are as follows. Because the sea beast also had 7 heads and 10 horns, it must, like the dragon, be part of the continuum of empires of Daniel 7. That's the first point. The second one is that the sea beast inherit something from each of the first 4 beasts of Daniel 7. And when you really get down to it, it still has its Babylonian nature and doctrine, the philosophy of Greece, the laws of the Medes and the Persians that are unchanging in their nature, and then the dragon-like nature, those first 4. And inherit something from all the 4 beasts. Just as our children inherit something from us and even from our grandparents as well. And the similarity is there between the two. The point number 3, it is the dragon that calls up the beast from the sea. And the dragon gave the sea beast his power and his throne and great authority. I mentioned that just now. And this implies that the sea beast is the dragon's successor. Since the dragon is the Roman Empire, when represented as having 7 heads and 10 horns, and the little horn is the real successor of the Roman Empire, Daniel 7, the sea beast is the little horn. Same thing, similarities we've looked at. All right. Further comparison of the little horn with the sea beast has proven this conclusion. What are they? Both persecute the saints for a time, times and half a time, both of them. And when you compare Revelation 12:6 with Revelation 12:14, you will see that time, times and a half is equal to 1260 days and 42 months. Same thing, times 30 days equal 1260 days. And a day in prophecy represents a year, therefore 1260 years. Both persecute for the same period of time. Both overpowered the saints. They prevailed against them, Daniel said. Daniel 7:21. Revelation 13:7 makes war against the saints and overcome them. And then both blaspheme God. That means they have a religious element attached to it. Blasphemy. What are the two highlighting characteristics of blasphemy? Claiming to be God and claiming to have power to forgive sins. The sea beast goes through 3 phases. It first arises from the sea, that's the first one, and then it dies, and then is resurrected, all as in Revelation 13. We've looked at those who read 13, 3, and 4. And after its resurrection, the Bible says the whole world was amazed and followed after the beast. And all who dwell on the earth will worship him, everyone whose name has been not been written in the from the foundation of the world in the life, the book of life of the Lamb who has been slain. Revelation 13, we've read that chapter already. I'm just recapping a few things to move on to get to this. This colored beast is different. Not the same thing as the dragon. Not the same thing as the sea beast. Not even the same thing as the one that rises from the earth. Not the same thing. This colored beast is different. How different? This colored beast of Revelation 17 is mentioned briefly in Revelation 11, 7. Let's look to a little, turn to Revelation 17 with me. Revelation, the 17th chapter, that's where we begin, really. All the rest is just recapping. Hope you can appreciate and understand what we are doing. Let's start from verse 1. Revelation 17, from verse 1. Anybody has it? Revelation 17, from verse 1. And there came one of the angels, which had the seven vials, and talked with me, saying unto me, come hither, and I will show unto thee the judgment. Notice the language carefully. The judgment of the great whore that sitteth upon many waters, with whom the kings of the earth have committed fornication, and the inhabitants of the earth have been made drunk with the wine of her fornication. So he carried me away in the spirit into the wilderness. So John had to go into the wilderness to see this woman, the great whore, sitting on many waters. And what did he see? And I saw a woman sit upon a scarlet colored beast, full of the names of blasphemy, having seven heads and ten horns. Very important. And the woman was arrayed in purple and scarlet colored. Interesting. How was the woman dressed? Purple and scarlet colored, and decked with gold and precious stones and pearls, having a golden cup in her hand, full of abominations and filthiness of her fornication. Of course, in this context, it will be spiritual fornication. That is, trying to join two things that should not be joined lawfully. A spiritual fornication. Anytime you try to join two things that should not be joined spiritually, in that context, it is spiritual fornication. Like trying to marry the church with the world. The two do not mix. Trying to mix worldly music with gospel music. Y'all have heard about gospel rock, right? Gospel spoof, gospel reggae, gospel dub, gospel everything now. Trying to marry two things that should not be married. The church and the state, that's a fornication too. The joining of the two, that's a fornication, spiritual fornication. Because one will emerge and dictate to the other. The state dictates to the church compromise, that's one problem. The church dominates and tells the state what to do. Whose laws will it be passing? Man-made laws, that's another problem. So if you're trying to be like the world and also like the church, that is a kind of spiritual fornication. That's what's mentioned in Jeremiah 3. And that's what's delaying the outpouring of the latter end. Because one of the characteristics the Bible gives is, for thou hast a whore's forehead, hence there has been no rain. Because you have gone a lean, L-I-E-N, lean, with other men. That's whoredoms. A serious thing. All right? So, spiritual fornication is a very serious thing where God is concerned. A very important. All right. Did I see a hand or something? Brother Peter?
When you read Revelation 17, what you're reading, it says that the beast, the woman, sorry, is the judgment of the great whore that sitteth upon many waters. Revelation 17:1. Mm-hmm. And then in 3, it said that John says that he was carried away into a wilderness.
The wilderness.
Into the wilderness And I saw a woman sit upon a scarlet colored beast. So in verse 1, the woman is on many waters. And in verse 3, John is carried into the wilderness to see a woman sitting on a scarlet colored beast.
Mm-hmm.
We know wilderness is the absence of water. In the wilderness, there is no water. So I try to figure what is John really trying to say by saying the woman is sitting on many waters, and then he carried John into the wilderness and see the woman sitting on the beast in the wilderness.
All right. My understanding of it based on the previous presentation is a wilderness represents a place of obscurity, a place out of the limelight. Yes, where it is not in the presence of the vast majority of the masses. It is no longer in the limelight with the masses. That's what it's really dealing with. It is out of sight. And we say out of sight, out of mind. So that is the evidence, one of the evidences that we use to show that the woman, which was God's church, fled into the wilderness, again a place of obscurity, out of the limelight, because she was being persecuted by the serpent. But here in Revelation 17, the great whore, the woman, is in the wilderness, which is out of the limelight of the masses of the people, the waters representing people. So it is no longer in a dominant role. It is no longer in the open, in the limelight. It is now in hiding, in seclusion, in obscurity. And the only timing that that can refer to by John giving that clue is after 1798. It is then that the Roman church went into obscurity, went into hiding when it received its deadly wound. So John's timing in terms of this particular passage is after 1798. So that when he begins to talk about five being fallen, he is talking about five being fallen before or during that period before 1798. Now we have Babylon, Medo-Persia, Grecia, pagan Rome, papal Rome, five are fallen. So if the timing is not right in terms of the point of view from which John is writing, then you're going to have it all wrong. Some people believe that John was writing with reference to his day, and the Roman power ruling was pagan Rome. And therefore, all of them refer to the Roman Empire, everything. Five fallen, one is all Roman. But if Revelation is the interpretation of Daniel, and it builds upon what was put down in the prophecies of Daniel, then you have to start where Daniel starts. And not only that, when you look at the beast that arises out of the sea, that is a composite beast, it gives the powers that existed before as symbols of those which existed in Daniel chapter 7. Head of a lion, feet of a bear, body of a leopard, feet of a bear, mouth of the lion, and then the dragon given this BCB power and seat and great authority. So the context of the word wilderness has to do with out of the limelight, not among the masses as being prominent or dominant, and that is where John had to go to see him. Not among the masses dominating or ruling as he was before. And that is what was presented previously. All right, Brother Peter? All right. So he carried me away in the spirit into the wilderness, and I saw a woman sit upon a scarlet colored beast full of the names of blasphemy, having seven heads and ten horns. And the woman was arrayed in purple and scarlet color and decked with gold and precious stones and pearls, having a golden cup in her hand full of the abomination of filthiness of her fornication. and upon her forehead. I want you to pay attention to the language. That's why I'm reading it, because they're coming back to do a little explanation. And upon her forehead was a name written, Mystery, Babylon the Great, the mother of harlots and abominations of the earth. Is that clear? Notice she called a mother of harlots. So she's a mother and she has daughters. And I saw the woman drunken with the blood of the saints and with the blood of the martyrs of Jesus. And when I saw her, I wondered with great admiration. All right. Verse 7. And the angel said unto me, wherefore didst thou marvel? I will tell thee, listen to the angel carefully, I will tell thee the mystery of the woman and of the beast that carrieth her. Which beast is that? What was the beast carrying her? Scarlet colored beast. Which hath seven heads and ten horns. All right, let's stop there a minute. So the scarlet colored beast is not the same as the sea beast of Revelation 13. It is not the same as the dragon of Revelation 12. And it is mentioned briefly, the sea beast. Mentioned briefly, the scarlet colored beast, sorry. Mentioned briefly in Revelation 11, 7. Let's read that a minute. Revelation 11, 7. This is Revelation 11, 7. And when they shall have finished their testimony, the beast that ascendeth out of the bottomless pit shall make war against them and shall overcome them and kill them. Beast that ascendeth out of the bottomless pit. But when you read Revelation 17 and verse 8, it says, the beast that thou sawest was and is not and shall ascend out of the bottomless pit and go into perdition. And then right. Out of the bottomless pit. That's just a brief mention of that term. The beast from the bottomless pit. All right. Just a mention. They differ, those differ in terms of associate. The sea beast receives its power from the dragon and gives its authority to the land beast, a beast that arises from the earth. All right? In Revelation, we often find this evil trio working together. What are they? The dragon. Let me hear you. The dragon, the beast, and the false prophet. That's the trio. In contrast, the scarlet colored beast is never mentioned as working with or having a relationship with any of this trio. A little more explanation. The scarlet colored beast is mentioned with Babylon. Revelation 17. While the evil trio, dragon, sea beast, and land beast, which is the false prophet, is never mentioned in the same breath as Babylon. It almost seems as if the different sets of symbols are used in Revelation 13 and 17. And we don't want to confuse terminology because there's a reason for that. In Revelation 13, the people worship what? The sea beast. The sea beast therefore reigns. In contrast, in Revelation 17, the harlot sits on the scarlet colored beast. Is that clear? That's the difference there. Sits on the scarlet colored beast. She therefore rules over the scarlet colored beast. Revelation 17, 18. While the scarlet colored beast, is presented in a subservient role. That is being ruled over. Therefore, while the sea beast rules, the scarlet colored beast is ruled over. That's the difference. The sea beast, Revelation 13, is ruling. And it receives a deadly wound. And then it rules again. But the scarlet colored beast is being ruled over. That is, the woman is sitting upon it. The woman is riding it. And they are reigned over. They are reigned over by the woman. Coming a little more. A little bit at a time. The relationships between the beast and the peoples of the world are also different. In Revelation 13, the sea beast is worshipped by the people. That's the sea beast. Revelation 13, the papacy, is worshipped by the people. And is therefore something apart from the people. They are worshipped by the people. So they are not the people. In contrast, in Revelation 17, the harlot, which is called Babylon, sits on both the beast and the waters. That is the harlot called Babylon the Great. The mystery, your name, mystery Babylon the Great. She sits on both the beast and on the many waters. And when you check Revelation 17, 1 and verse 15, you will see that waters represent people. I saw a great whore sit upon many waters. And in Revelation 17, 15, the waters which thou sawest are multitudes and nations and tongues and people, indicating a close relationship between the beast and the people. So there's a close relationship between the scarlet colored beast of Revelation 17 and the people. The water, the woman sits on the beast. The woman sits on many waters, And yet it says, he took me away into the wilderness and I saw a woman sit upon a scarlet colored beast. So there's an association or relationship between that beast, scarlet colored beast, and the peoples. But not so much with the sea beast. Sea beast rules the people. This one, the people are ruled over by the woman. That's a difference there we need to bear in mind. Now, what is scarlet colored beast? The scarlet colored beast is, it is therefore clear that the scarlet colored beast is something different from the dragon and the sea beast. But the scarlet colored beast must relate in some way to the beast of Daniel 7 because it has seven heads and 10 horns. And can we count 7 heads and 10 horns in Daniel 7? Yes. And there's a relationship between that and the beast in Revelation, in Daniel chapter 7. Whenever it boils down, it will be a combination of those 7 beasts. Whenever it boils down, all right? But there's a relationship there. Now to get into this. First point, the scarlet colored beast exists for all of human history. We're going to prove that. That the scarlet colored beast exists for all of human history. The mother whore is mentioned in chapter 17 as Babylon the Great. Not just Babylon. Anybody knows when the announcement was first made that Babylon is fallen? When was that first made? Babylon is fallen, is fallen. When was that announcement first made? Anybody know? In 1844, the summer of 1844. And to whom did it have a more direct application? To those churches that had rejected the third angel's message that constituted Babylon. They experienced a moral fall, but it was not complete. Since then, they have been falling and falling and falling, and they will reach the height of their rebellion or apostasy just before or around the time of the loud cry. By the time the other churches would have joined them, that would have apostatized from the truth. Other churches would have joined them to form Babylon the Great. So the loud cry message is really a repetition of the second angel's message of Revelation 14, but with greater power and more inclusive of not just the churches that fell in 1844, but other churches that constituted Babylon since 1844, from forming Babylon the Great. So I want you to hear that in mind, because when I come back to that, or I use the terms, you will know what I'm talking about. Babylon the Great represents false or apostate religion. This harlot or great Babylon exists for all of human history. How do we know that? Proof? Turn to me, Revelation 18, verse 24. I want you to take there with me. Revelation 18, verse 24. Get the proof for yourself. How do we know that this colored beast or Babylon, great Babylon, exists for all of human history? Babylon first, and then the formation of great Babylon. Revelation 18, 24 says, and in her, referring to who? Babylon. In her was found the blood of the prophets and of saints and of all that were slain upon the earth. So right in the cup of Babylon are found the blood of all the prophets and of the saints and of all that were slain upon the earth. That's the first point. This harlot, this false apostate church, as a matter of fact, it was formed around the time of the Tower of Babel. But of course, that spirit existed before that, when Cain killed Abel. And that is where Babylon came from. That mystical, that religion of Babylon came by people's effort to build a tower, to reach into heaven, to save themselves in case there is another flood. So Babylon stretches all the way back to that time. That's early days. And the Bible says, in her was found all the blood of the prophet and of the saints and all who have been slain upon the earth. And because she is the mother, and the word mother would represent origin of harlots. Revelation 17, 5. She is a mother. She is the mother, the origin of harlots. In Revelation 17, Babylon is represented as a woman, a figure which is used in the Bible as a symbol of a church, a virtuous woman. Symbol is used of the church. A virtuous woman represents a pure church, and a vile woman represents an apostate church. That is Great Controversy 381. Let me read that again. In Revelation 17, Babylon is represented as a woman, a figure which is used in the Bible as the symbol of a church. A virtuous woman representing a pure church, a vile woman, an apostate church. If she existed for all of human history, the same must apply to the scarlet beast which she sits upon and rides. In contrast, the sea beast of Revelation 13 is a specific organization coming into existence at a specific point in time when it comes out of the sea and of the human population. That's the sea beast. All right? But that's different to the scarlet colored beast. So you can't compare the two. They are not the same. Also, the land beast, what we call the United States of America. The land beast of Revelation 13, again, is a specific power or organization coming into existence at a specific point in time, making an image of the first beast, which had the wound by a sword, and giving life to the image of the beast. Therefore, it cannot be the scarlet beast of Revelation 17. The two are not the same. And there's a reason why I'm equating this here. All right? Next point. The scarlet beast represents the kings of the earth. Let's turn to Revelation 17, verse 18. Let's read verse 18 of Revelation 17. Verse 18 of Revelation 17. Remember earlier it said the great horse sits upon many waters. Then when John was carried into the wilderness, he saw a woman sit upon a scarlet colored beast. Look at verse 18 now. And the woman which thou sawest is that great city which reigneth over who? The kings of the earth. The harlot, Babylon the Great, sitting on the scarlet beast is explained right here in Revelation 17, 18. The woman whom you saw is that great city which reigns over the kings of the earth. Because the scarlet beast represents the kings and kingdoms of the world, and because it exists for the whole of human history, it must represent all the kingdoms of Daniel 7. It cannot be limited to only one of those kingdoms. It therefore includes, notice my language, it therefore includes both the dragon, the sea beast, and the land beast. Includes all three. Next point. That's obvious from the previous statement. The sea beast is included in Babylon. How do we prove that? This is clear when the sea beast makes war with the saints and to overcome them. Revelation 13:7. While actually Babylon must carry the blame for all martyr deaths of God's people. So you imagine that? The sea beast overcame the saints, made war against them, shed the blood of saints and martyrs. And yet Babylon takes over all responsibility for the blood of the martyrs and of the saints and all those who have been killed on the earth. So the sea beast is included in Babylon. It carries the blame for all the martyrs' death of God's people. Revelation 18 and verse 24. This is also indicated by the fact that the sea beast is in charge, similar to Babylon. That's in Revelation 13. All right. So we have a beast. So the beast has functioned through all the successive powers that have existed before. That's why John says, the beast thou sawest was, is not, and yet is. The beast was, is not, and shall ascend out of the bottomless pit. The same dragon-like, beastly, persecuting nature that it manifested through the papacy, that will be manifested through the United States of America, because the United States of America rose like an innocent lamb, two horns like a lamb, but it will speak as a dragon's voice again coming out. The dragon's roar coming out. Are you following me? But starts off innocent with Christian principles, but later apostatizing, becoming the false prophet, apostate Protestantism. First in the USA, and then spread to the rest of the world. We're going to prove all of that. I don't like to jump to conclusions like that. So Revelation 17, Revelation 17, by mentioning the woman and the scarlet colored beast, is really presenting the anti-God or anti-Christian powers for all of human history, but shows that it consists of two components, a political power, a beast, and a religious, a harlot component, those two. So the two aspects, a religious component and a political component. With the religious component reigning over the political. I don't know if you're following me there. All right? But that is why John uses the language, the beast that thou sawest, upon which the woman sitteth, scarlet colored beast, was, that is, it existed in the past, is not, and shall ascend out of the bottomless pit and go into perdition. So we are not dealing here with any particular head per se, because the beast has the seven heads. We are dealing with the beast itself, its nature, what it does when it is ruling, and how it has ruled over the past heads and will rule over in the case of the seventh head. I hope you get that link there. Let me go over that again. Revelation 17, therefore, presents the anti-God powers for all of human history. And it is called Woman, with her name written, Mystery Babylon the Great, the mother of harlots. And she reigns over the kings of the earth. What are we talking about? We are talking about a conglomerate. Watch it. It consists of two components, a political power, or component, and a religious power, component, a harlot. Two of them. But this case is one in which they are united, just as it was seen also that the sea beast, which represents the papacy, that same anti-God power consisted of both political and religious component. So the papacy was both religious and political at the same time. It was blasphemous, meaning it was religious in nature, and it was also political as a beast power. But limited, listen to this, but limited to one specific organization in one period of human history at one point in time. Remember I said earlier that the beast functions through its heads? You remember I said that? The beast functions through its head, not the big toe, not any feet. The beast functions through its heads. So in the case of Babylon, the beast functioned through Babylon. What was the purpose of the beast functioning through Babylon? To seek to destroy God's people at the time. Same thing for Media Persia, Grecia, pagan Rome. The same thing. The beast in the case of pagan Rome represented the dragon, the Roman pagan religion at the time, seeking to destroy the man-child Jesus when he was born, and even to get rid of the church. And then we have the papacy, which is a merger of the political and the religious in one. I hope you're following me here, because I'm trying to arrive at a conclusion. So just as we have seen that the CBs represented that same anti-God power consists of both political and religious component, but limited to one specific organization in one period of time of human history at one point in time. All right. Hear me out first, right? The symbolism of Revelation 17 informs us that the kingdoms of the world are always under the control of the deceiving influence of Babylon. Babylon, Revelation 17, 2, tells us with whom the kings of the earth had committed fornication. So Babylon corrupts the minds of people, and it kills the saints. Revelation 18, 24 tells us that all the blood of the martyrs and of the saints are found in the cup of Babylon. Babylon kills the saints. And Babylon exists during all of the empires of Daniel 7. Remember, there are three aspects of Babylon. There's Babylon, the empire. Yeah. Then there's Babylon, the city. Then there is Babylon, the religion. Which one exists today? Babylon, the empire, Babylon, the city, or Babylon, the religion? Which one exists today? Babylon, the religion. All right. In the case of Revelation 17, the woman who is called Babylon the Great is sitting, I want you to notice carefully, sitting on the scarlet colored beast, riding the scarlet colored beast, and said to be full of the names of blasphemy, having seven heads and ten horns. Not only has she, Babylon, committed fornication, which is illicit or unlawful union of joining with the kings of the earth, verse 2, but she has also made them drunk with the wine of her fornication. So a lot of things happening here. The woman is sitting. The woman is riding a beast full of the names of blasphemy. The woman is committing fornication with the kings of the earth. And the woman has made them drunk. So the chief or main character in Revelation 17 is really the woman. And where do we find the judgment against the woman coming in? Like the first verse says, come and I will show you the judgment of the great whore. The judgment is mentioned in the last three verses of Revelation 17. That's where the judgment is mentioned. It says, the 10 horns which thou sawest upon the beast, these shall hit the whore and shall make her desolate and naked and shall eat her flesh and burn her with fire. For God hath put it in their heart to fulfill his will and to agree and to give their kingdom unto the beast until the words of God shall be fulfilled. That is the judgment upon the whore that sits upon many waters. And John will say, come, I will show you the judgment of the woman, this whore, sit upon many waters. But first he said, she was in the wilderness. I saw her in the wilderness. And this, she was riding a beast. And look at the description of this beast. And this beast was and is not, and yet is going to come into existence again. Let me tell you something. I'm going to show you the mystery of this woman and of the beast that carrieth her. I'm going to tell you, that's the language of the Bible. And that's clear Bible language as it explains it. All right, let's go a little further. So, what is it that we are talking about? Okay, what is it we are talking about? This is what we call, since it has two components, it is a religious political power. Woman, a church, religious, and the kings of the earth, the state or the political. Blasphemy is a religious word, claiming to be God or claiming to have power to forgive sins. I was looking for the references there, but I probably didn't get back to change it. Matthew 8, where Jesus says, man, thy sins are forgiven thee. And they said, this man is committing blasphemy. Who can forgive sins but God alone? And in John chapter 10, where Jesus said, before Abraham was, I am claiming to be God. And they said, so this man, while being a man, because of you committing blasphemy, you are but a mere man and you are claiming to be God. And they call it blasphemy. So this power is both religious, a church, and political, a state, kings of the earth. Blasphemy, religious in nature, and wine. She made the nations drink of the wine of the wrath of her fornication. What would wine represent? One reference we look at, the other is Luke chapter 5 and verse 37. Luke chapter 5, verse 37. It's a part two to this, but it deals more with the U.S.-led coalition and what it intends to achieve, which I call the seventh head. Wine, Luke 5, verse 37. What did Jesus say? Let's start with verse 36. And he spake unto them a parable unto them. No man put if a piece of new garment upon an old. If otherwise, then both the new maketh a rent, and the piece that was taken out of the new agreeth not with the old. And no man putteth new wine into old bottles, else the new wine will burst the bottles and be spilled, and the bottles shall perish. But the new wine shall be put into new bottles, and both are preserved. No man also having drunk old wine straightway deserve new. For he saith, the old is better. What was Jesus talking about? He was talking about his doctrine. New wine in old bottles. The old bottles could not handle the new wine. The doctrine that Jesus, that's why Jesus said, beware of the doctrine of the scribes and the Pharisees. That's what Jesus warned against. So wine represents doctrine. And the nations have been, listen to the language, the kings of the earth have been made drunk with the doctrines of Babylon's illicit union or marriage. So the false doctrine that Babylon has will become part of the nations. The kings of the earth will imbibe them, and they will have the same composition as Babylon. What does the Bible say about the colors that the woman is dressed in? The woman was clothed with what? Purple and scarlet. That's the woman's dress. And what's the color of the beast that she sits on? Scarlet. So the color of that the woman is dressed in is also a part of the color of the beast. Scarlet colored. Of course, those two have symbolism. What does purple represent? Another important aspect. The woman is dressed in purple, representing what? I never gave you the biblical symbolism presentation, the different symbols and what they mean and the biblical evidence. There's a whole handout I have on that. But purple represents royalty. Yeah? Purple represents royalty. And the scarlet represented what? Though your sins be as scarlet. Scarlet is also associated with sinfulness, bloodstain, evil practices. Now that's significant. And that's in Isaiah 1. That's in Isaiah 1. So that's why we have the woman full of the abominations and the filthiness of her fornication. And that is why we have the scarlet colored beast full of the names of blasphemy. Both of them are corrupt. The woman riding the scarlet colored beast, which has the same colors as the woman is decked with. So they are a match. They are a matching pair. The woman, purple and scarlet. The beast, scarlet colored. So they are matching. And that happens a lot at weddings too, right? The husband dressed one way, the wife is matching color. Usually every bridesmaid, every have an off to that color or a similar color attached, related to that color. And that's significant. That's very significant to my mind. All right? Now, let's continue here. So wine represents false doctrines. The kings of the earth have been so persuaded, watch this language, the kings of the earth have been so persuaded and imbibed the false doctrines of Babylon that they have been made intoxicated, drunk with the wine of her fornication, and therefore are sharing her thinking. That's the important point I want to get over. Sharing her thinking. Where in the Revelation 17 do you find that same language about sharing their thinking? Well, right there in Revelation 17, these have one mind. There's a union. One mind. But before I go there, let me just go here. To show you what we're talking about, Babylon's cup is full at one point in time to become Babylon the Great at a certain point in time. Babylon's cup is full to become Babylon the Great. Now, when you read the Great Controversy, page 604, there around, you will see that when God calls his people to declare the final warning message, it will be then that the cup of iniquity of Babylon will be full, and the people of God will be called upon to go and expose the sins of Babylon. For her sins have reached unto heaven, the Bible said. So Babylon's cup will be full when Babylon the Great is fully formed. Both have all filled up the cup of their iniquity, both of them. Both the woman and the scarlet colored beast have both filled up the cup of their iniquity and abomination full. The woman has her cup full of the abominations and filthiness of her fornication, as well as with the blood of the saints and the blood of the martyrs of Jesus. The woman is full. That's why she's scarlet colored. She's scarlet colored because she is full of the woman, that is, the abomination and filthiness of her fornication, as well as with the blood of the saints and the blood of the martyrs of Jesus. That's why she is clothed in purple and scarlet color. But we are told that this scarlet beast is also scarlet colored. It's also full of the names of blasphemy. That's verse 4. And her cup is also full. So we have two that are filled up. What's the timing? What's the timing of the formation of Babylon the Great? What's the timing? If we can find out the timing, we can know when the seventh head would have been formed. The timing. Watch it. This is the burden of the initial loud Christ messengers who are called upon to declare that Babylon the Great is or has fallen, verse 2, after Babylon has fallen. You don't send a person with a message to say that Babylon has fallen and it hasn't fallen yet. You send a message that Babylon is fallen or has fallen after it has fallen. So Babylon the Great has to be formed first and then fall. They reach the height of the iniquity. Revelation 18 says, her sins have reached unto heaven, and God have remembered her iniquities. So the cup of Babylon would have been full. And that is what leads to the complete fall of Babylon. Babylon completely falls when it becomes full. And when it falls, God's people are called to come and preach and expose that Babylon has fallen, and what it is made up of. The hole of every foul spirit, the cage of every unclean and hateful bird, corruption to its height, complete moral fall. Now, it will be because Babylon's cup is full, and all nations have drunk, and the kings of the earth have committed fornication, that the judgment deems that her sins be exposed. That's very important. So we're coming in here with the judgment now. All right? Now, better boom.
That's two things. One, the message Babylon has fallen, is that message to the papacy?
Yes.
To the papacy?
In 1840, if it to be given?
Is given to the papacy?
I don't understand the word.
The message that Babylon is fallen.
That's in Revelation 14.
Is that message given to the papacy?
If it is given to the?
The papacy.
To the papacy?
Yes.
It was given to the churches that had a moral fall in 1844.
Right.
So it was not directed to the papacy per se, but all those daughters of Babylon at the time that had fallen. But the papacy had experienced its fall before that.
Right, so this message then that is given is not a message to the papal church.
Right.
It's a message to the churches who came out from the papacy.
That constitute Babylon.
Receive a racial fall. And then those who came out from that fall, that first fall, all of those who apostatize now is included in this general message that is to be given.
Right.
So then,
so this the first grape, call was given to the papacy during a period of time. So the second call is to be given.
So then this great Babylon that is given this message is not then the churches including the papacy, is the churches excluding the papacy.
Churches throughout Christendom, yeah. So but then, it includes everybody.
So then this great Babylon, this great Babylon is then the churches of Christendom.
Yes.
Good.
Those that have been influenced by papal doctrine, that have been drunk by the doctrines of the papacy.
Right.
That represent her in some form or another.
You know, in Daniel chapter 2, it's given all the phases of the different, from Babylon.
Metals.
Mm-hmm. Metals. And then Daniel 7 is repeated in a different way.
Right.
And then in Daniel 8 is repeated in a different way.
Right.
And then in Daniel 11 is repeated in a different way. In Revelation chapter 12, it is given the papacy and the United States. Because the earth opened and helped the woman. So that is really referring to the United States of America. So both the papacy and the United States of America is found in Daniel chapter 12.
Daniel chapter?
In Revelation chapter 12.
You mean 13?
No, Revelation 12. Remember, the earth opened,
okay,
and received the woman. So, mm-hmm. so
the earth helped the woman, which represents Protestant, right, America, right, opening their doors, right, to those who are fleeing from papal persecution.
So it represents the United States of America.
Yeah.
When you go into Revelation 13, you have the first beast being the papacy, and then the second beast being in reference to the United States of America again. So,
right,
you have an amplification of what, right, has happened, right, in 12.
But the final stage is mentioned at the end.
No, in 17, should there not be an amplification of what has happened in 12 and in 13?
Yes.
So where
and there is.
So where then is the beast that is in Revelation 13 found, that the beast that is in Revelation 13, which refers to Protestant America and Protestant United States of America,
right,
where then is that found in Revelation 17?
That's the next chapter. That's our next presentation. But it's on the ten horns. I'll tell you up front, it is the 10 horns. And that's the next presentation. U.S.-led coalition, the seventh head. And it will show how the United States is mentioned, the Protestantism is mentioned in Revelation 17. But I'm just dealing with this scarlet color. So you're right. Both the papacy and the United States of America, the earth helping the woman, are found in Revelation 12. But the last verse says, and the dragon was wroth with the woman and went to make war with the remnant of her seed. That's what we call the last ditch effort of Satan to persecute and to destroy God's church. In Revelation 13, it is the first beast that has been given an image, made an image to, sorry, by the second beast of Revelation 13. That seeks to persecute or leads out in persecution of God's people. But before it can do that, it has to get a confederacy, a union together in order to persecute. And that is what we call seven women taking hold of one man, saying that we would wear our own apparel, eat our own food, meat, and but only let us be called by thy name. Now, earlier I mentioned, and in Revelation 17, yes, you have the papacy mentioned as being in the wilderness, but then you also have the 10 horns. I don't want to get into that now. The 10 horns, which have received no kingdom as yet, but received power as kings 1 hour with the beast. And the spread of prophecy says that power, the 10 horns represent Protestantism. I'll come back to that one next week if we finish this evening, which I doubt. All right. What I'm looking here at is, I'll come back to that next week, God is willing. What we are here looking at here, the timing of the formation of Babylon the Great. What's the timing? This is the burden of the initial loud cry messengers. They have to know when Babylon the Great is fallen. Just as in 1844, God's people knew that the judgment had come, that the work of the judgment had begun. They had to know it in order to preach the message, because their message was, the hour of God's judgment is come. So they had to have known, according to the prophecies, that it had come in order to preach that the message of God's judgment is come. The same thing is true when the people of God begin to preach the loud cry and say, Babylon the Great has fallen, They have to know that Babylon had fallen, that it reached the cup. The cup had been full. The iniquity of Babylon is full in order to show that it has fallen. Because Babylon falls because she has become too heavy with the blood of the martyrs, the blood of the saints. And she's filled up the measure of her abomination on the earth. The cup of Babylon. Notice the name given to the woman is Mystery what? Babylon the Great, the mother of Harlem. All right, so it's not just the woman we're talking about, but we're talking about the daughter harlots. And the daughter harlots, really, we'll come to that next week, are the 10 kings. Because the 10 horns, sorry, which are 10? The 10 horns are on the beast. The 10 horns are on the beast. And you read it, Revelation 17. We'll prove that. 10 horns are on the beast. So they have the same beastly origin. They would have come out from the beast. They are not separate from the beast. They are part of the beast. They are the daughters of the woman. And there's a time when they will have one mind. One mind with 1 hour with the beast. They will receive their kingdom, their crowns. 1 hour in a confederacy, a union, an illicit fornication or joining with the beast. And that is what is going to lead to the downfall. When they give all their power and so on to the beast. And then regret it afterward. That's what we're talking about here. So let's get the timing again. It is during the preaching of the Lord. It is during the preaching of the loud cry message that the voice will be heard saying what? Come out of her, my people. Come out of her who? Babylon the Great. Come out of her, my people, that ye be not partakers of her sins and that ye receive not of her plagues. And it is at this point that her sins have reached unto heaven and God have remembered her iniquity. So let's get the conclusion. It is around the period of the formation of the seventh head, that Babylon the Great, the confederacy that Isaiah mentions in Isaiah 4:1. Seven women taking hold of one man. Union, Isaiah 4:1, union of the church with the state, that the papacy will be resurrected. And the final loud cry warning message given to mankind will be given. Now, I mentioned papacy here. Of course, we are all apt to think that the papacy represents the Roman church. But according to inspiration, the papacy also is a term that is used to represent the union of church and state and use of using its power to persecute heretics. That's we talk about the development of the papacy. And the spread of prophecy calls it the union of the church with the state, using its powers to persecute heretics. A definition of papacy that we don't normally use, but we use it to apply only to the Roman church. But that is why I said the seventh head is really the US-led coalition of Babylon the Great. That will be the final persecuting power against God's people. U.S.-led. All other nations will follow the example of the United States of America. That's a quotation they have to share with you next week. The United States will start off first, but all other nations, foreign nations, will follow her example, which will be all the evil atrocities and cruelties that were enacted by the papal church at the time will be resurrected and manifested through that last papal head. And who will lead out? Protestant America. Apostate Protestantism will lead in that. I have quotations on that to share with you and biblical evidence as well. The more I study it, the more I see it coming out clearly. I mean, I may be wrong on some point. Don't get me wrong. But the more I study it, the more I see it coming out pretty clearly. It's making more and more sense to me. It's all adding up. So it is around the period of the formation of the seventh head, Babylon the Great, the confederacy of Isaiah 4:1, union of the church with the state, that the papacy will be resurrected, and the final loud cry warning message to mankind will be preached. So that's the timing of the seventh head, the timing of it. Now, persecution will be revived against God's church. So right now we are living a time of ease, and members can choose to come to church or not come to church. They can choose to have a piece of the world and a piece of the church. They can choose whatever they want. But when the fires of persecution begin to burn again, and why will they burn? Because the church will be living so close to God that it will arouse the animosity of the world. What did Jesus say? All that will live godly in Christ Jesus shall suffer persecution. Why does persecution seem to slumber now? Because the church is compromising with the world. Members are dressing like the world, following the same customs as the world, liking the same music as the world, following the same mission as the world, but they are not following after the things of God. That is why persecution seems to slumber. They are so together that you can hardly distinguish between the two. They are so together. They look alike. They dress alike. They are identified with each other so that there's no need for persecution of each other. That's what we are talking about. The resurrection, however, of persecution will be the healing of the deadly wound, the union of church and state again, and then persecutions will start back again. Persecution fires will burn again because the church is distinct, moving in union with her master under the banner of Prince Emmanuel, and this will arouse the animosity of those who don't like or want to accept Christ. So persecution will be revived against God's church. It is then that the dragon will be wroth with the woman and seek to make war with the remnant of her seed, Revelation 12:17. And it is then that the image of the first beast will be formed. Just look at the timing. Give on life and speak that those who do not comply with its religious laws should neither buy nor sell and should be killed. All that's in Revelation 13. Not only that, timing we're looking at. It is then that people will worship the beast and his image. The first one we quote just now was Revelation 13. First one I give you is Revelation 12. Revelation 12:17, the dragon was wroth with the woman, went to make war with the man. Revelation 13 shows war again. People of God will be reached a point where they will neither be able to buy nor sell, except they have the mark, and a decree will be made that they should be killed. War again, verse 13. Is there war in verse 14, chapter 14? Chapter 14. It is then that the people will worship the beast and his image and receive his mark in his forehead, in the forehead on the right hand. That's Revelation 14. Revelation 14. Let's go a little further. We're looking at timing again. It is then that the three unclean spirits, like frogs, will come out of the mouth of the dragon and out of the mouth of the beast and out of the mouth of the false prophet, which are the spirits of devils working miracles, and go forth unto the kings of the earth and of the whole world to do what? To gather them to the great day, the battle of the great day of God Almighty. As war again. So in chapter 16, war is again mentioned. War again with the three unclean spirits from the trio. What does God have? That's the counterfeit of what God has. God has three messages that will unite God's people together and expose the sins of Babylon, the three angels' messages. That is why the three angels' messages of Revelation 14 is sandwich between Revelation 13 and Revelation 15, which deals with the closure of probation and God's people being seen victorious, standing on the sea of glass. And Revelation 13, the mark of the beast system. That is the context in which the three angels' messages are to be preached. The context, that is. So Revelation 16 deals with war. How about Revelation 17? Does it deal with that war? Does it give us the timing as well? Same timing of the seventh age? The seventh age is the last power that will wage war against God's church. Seventh power. He's called the eighth to, he is the eighth and is of the seven. Let me just go to that and close with it. All right? Revelation 17, it is then that there will be one mind and shall give their power and strength unto the beast. These shall make war with the Lamb and they that are with him. Revelation 17, 13 and 14. All right. Now, symbolisms here are important. We got time. We got to stop now. But let me stop with summarizing this symbolism here. And that is, woman is dressed in purple. And purple represents royalty. Mark 15, 17, Judges 8, 26. That's significant. Why? Because if purple symbolizes royalty, and a woman is dressed in purple, what does that mean? She's a part of royalty. And if she is part of royalty, she would have to be a queen. Part of royalty. I sit a queen and I'm no widow. Revelation 17, 18, 7. Purple. Meaning the time when she becomes married to the state again. And scarlet, sin, corruption, Isaiah 1:18, Nahum 2:3, Revelation 17, 1-4. Scarlet, red. Bloodstain, sin, corruption, whatever. The symbolisms of color are important. Scarlet. Though your sin be as scarlet. The Bible likens them to be corrupted like scarlet. Revelation 17, 7, and okay, that's a different area we're getting into there. All right. All right, I'll continue that next week. God is willing. All right, so there's a little more to look at here. And just to conclude this color beast, before we get into the U.S.-led coalition, which I call, what the Bible calls, Babylon the Great. A woman sitting on and riding the scarlet colored beast full of the names of blasphemies and having in her, as a matter of fact, having united with the woman, being ridden by the woman and reigned over by the woman and accomplishing the ends of the woman. And then at the end of it, all turned against the woman and seek to destroy her. All of that is critically important. But we said that this colored beast really represents the conglomerate of all the powers that have come before. The Bible calls it Babylon the Great. The formation. And in Babylon the Great are found the blood of all the martyrs and of the saints and all that have been ever slain on the earth. All of that is found in the cup of Babylon. So this Babylon the Great is a combination of the woman and the beast that she rides. She is in control of the state, the political element, the kings of the earth. She is now married to them. She herself says in Revelation 18, I sit a queen and I'm no more widow. No widow. She became a widow when the death blow was given in 1798. So she became separated from the state. The state power was removed from the church. So she became a widow. Now she, in Revelation 17, she has remarried. She is married to the kings of the earth. She is now royalty. She is the queen. Now she is riding the kings of the earth. She's controlling, like how Jezebel controlled Ahab to achieve her ends for his sake. We have a repetition in the future of that Old Testament story in the book of Kings. All right, I pray that as we move on a little more, there's a little bit by bit, but we are seeing, to my mind, I'm seeing a few things gel together that describes this colored beast that unites, harmonizes with the 10 kings, the 10 horns that we shall look at next, who will have one mind with the beast and be crowned, become kingdoms, receive power as kings. 1 hour with the beast. We're going to see that in the next presentation. You had a question? I'm going to stop there for the time being, but there's a little more to go on.
In Revelation 17 and verse
3,
the scarlet, the woman is upon a scarlet colored beast. Is this the period of the is not period of the beast?
Yes. John says he was carried away into the spirit, into the wilderness. That is the is not period. But the one with the woman sitting, and I saw, is a new line. And I saw is a new line. Whenever the revelation, John says, and I saw, it is a new line of seeing that are being presented. And even though it's in the same verse, it doesn't mean it's the same time period. This represents the period when the beast yet is. Not is not, yet is. The time when she shall be united fully with the state, the kings of the earth, the political power, riding again, is a queen, and reigning and ruling over them to achieve her own ends. So that is the yet is period, or should I say, the shall ascend out of the bottomless pit period. Shall ascend out of the bottomless pit. Revelation 17, verse 8. Shall ascend out of the bottomless pit. So right now it is in the bottomless pit. It is out of sight. It is dead. It is in the abyss. And we've already shown that the abyss refers to the place of the dead. Out of obscurity, right now, the is not period. That's the period when the beast is in the wilderness, which is our time. But the yet is period, or the period of shall ascend out of the bottomless pit, is the U.S.-led coalition of the seventh head of Revelation 17. That is what we are saying. Brother McLean, you follow me though? Oh, okay. Any questions on this presentation? I know there are others jumping, but the next time we'll finish off this and go into the U.S.-led coalition, which is the seventh head. It's important. Whatever overcomes atheism and seeks to solve the problems of the world and appears to be rising out to influence and to be having control is the one that overcomes atheism. How do we know that that's correct? I have a slide here that shows it must harmonize with the prophecy of Daniel 11. What does Daniel 11 say overcomes the king of the south? Huh? The king of the north. But there was the king of the south that overcame the king of the north, which is Babylon. Atheism overcame Babylon. But then the Bible says, but the king of the north shall come back against him like a whirlwind. So Daniel 11 harmonizes with what I just told you. It is the resurrected papacy or the apostate church coming up now in another form to control the world. And that will be the last power. And the Bible says, many shall be overthrown and they shall enter into the glorious land and seek to overthrow many. But there are some that shall escape. And then the Bible says, tidings, listen, timing, tidings out of the east and out of the north, representing what? The loud cry again. Tidings out of the east and out of the north shall trouble him, and he shall come to his end, and none shall help him. So we have to link Daniel with Revelation, and we cannot go around there once you get the parallels of Daniel with Revelation. So if Revelation proves it and Daniel sanctions it, then that is what it must be. The seventh head must also be a religious, intolerant, persecutory power, just like the others. A religious, intolerant, anti-God, persecutory power. And that is what the seventh head must be. All right? All right, thank God for his word. His word gives clarity. It not only gives clarity, it gives direction. And his word also gives strength. And it gives stability to God's people. That is why I like the prophecies a lot. It gives stability. It gives strength. It gives direction. It gives hope. And it tells you that you can trust God's word, because that word has come to pass and will come to pass. And therefore, once we hold on to the word of God and the truth of God, when the truth of God triumphs, we too will triumph with it. May the Lord bless his word to our heart. So let's sing that song again that we started with. Look for the waymarks, the great prophetic waymark. The journey almost over. Number 596 to close. Then we'll have our closing prayer. 596. You see, the prophecies offer a word of comfort, strength, and encouragement. 596 again to close. Look for the waymarks. We should be students of the word and the prophecies of Daniel and Revelation, which will give us an entirely different religious experience. 596. Then we have our closing prayer. Let's start. Look for the way marks as you journey on. Look for the way mark passing one by one. Down through the ages, past the kingdom's fall. Where are we standing? Look the way mark so. Look for the way mark, the great prophetic way mark. Down through the ages, past the kingdom's fall. Oh, look for the way mark, the great prophetic way mark. The journey's almost over. First the Assyrian kingdom ruled the world, then Medo-Persia's banners were unfurled, and after Greece seized the scepter. Where are we today? Look for the way mark, the great prophetic way mark. Down through the ages, past the kingdom's fall. Oh, look for the way mark, the great prophetic way mark. The journey's almost over. Down iron and the clay, weak and divided, soon to pass away. What will the next great glorious drama be? Christ and his coming and eternity. Look for the way mark, the great prophetic way mark. Down through the ages, past the Let us pray. Our dear God and Father, we have traced your prophetic guidelines this evening, looking at the scarlet-colored beast. We have recognized that soon to occur will be for the formation of Babylon the Great, led by the USA, that will have become one mind with the beast and will give their power and strength unto the beast to seek to make war with the Lamb and to overcome them that are with him. But we are thankful that your true people will be called and chosen and faithful. We are thankful for your prophetic guidelines that outline what will yet occur in the future. Though we must not be dogmatic, we must let the prophetic scroll unroll and seek to follow your guidance, the guidance of your Holy Spirit. May the same Holy Spirit that inspired John and Daniel inspire us to understand what they have written, so that we shall come to a clear knowledge and understanding of the truth of your word, so that we can have an entirely different religious experience. Deliver us from lukewarmness. Deliver us from skylarking with you, not taking you serious, and to be committed to the study of your word, not like the foolish virgins to waste time during the period of preparation, not like the foolish virgins not putting in extra oil during the time of emergency, but like the wise storing up the extra oil during the time of preparation, so that when the bridegroom comes, we shall be able to follow him whithersoever he goeth. Bless, guide, and direct. Continue to teach us by your Spirit what we need to know for this time, and inspire us in Jesus' precious name. Amen. Let the words of our mouth and the meditations of our heart be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. All right, God bless you. Have a wonderful week of victory in Jesus. I'm not sure of any announcement, if anyone has announcement.